I love it. Our next guest is always having a little cunny, or already having a little cunny next to me, a little boogie. Look, but we are talking about the MIQ review, looking into it this morning. So three reports into cases of COVID-19 transmission within managed isolation facilities were released by the Ministry of Health yesterday. The main conclusion? Airborne transmission was the most plausible cause of the virus passing between guests, which is something our next guest was saying on breakfast way back in January. So we're really happy to welcome him back to the show for his victory lap and his little victory dance he was doing earlier. Joe Rindelaub, a research fellow at Auckland University School of Chemical Sciences. Welcome to the show this week.
Yeah, Ata Mare, glad to be here.
A bit of a vindication for the man with an amazing mullet.
Vindication, a scientist craves not these things.
Yes.
But I am happy to see that the government actually listens to us science nerds and will, you know, do an investigative report on this kind of thing.
And you guys, the last time you came on, you did say that you and your colleagues had been saying this was a concern, airborne transmission, way back in April last year. So before we go into the advice that they've taken on board, can you break down how that actually works?
Yeah, exactly. So when you sneeze or you cough, or just us talking right now, we are expelling tiny little invisible droplets just in the air. And if we don't have some good ventilation to escort them out of this room, then they're just gonna hang out and party.
And how long can they hang out and party? Like, you're talking about, because the tiny, tiny particles can really hang around for a while.
Oh, absolutely. And by hang out and party, I mean, you know, try to replicate in your body ad nauseum inside your flush machine. So we gotta make sure that doesn't happen. And these particles can hang out for, hours in the air if there isn't enough clean air to brush them aside and make sure that that's clean breathing.
If we look at what's happening in Australia right now with their current outbreak, and there are a few cases where there is no known link, but health officials there have talked about fleeting contact as being, you know, perhaps the source of transmission. So that is airborne transmission.
That's basically airborne transmission, where you have these aerosols, these tiny micro droplets that are just hanging out in the air, chill, going with the flow, can sit there, and then, you know, like right now, we are probably exchanging little tiny droplets. We're spitting in each other's mouth. It's pretty gross. That's why we're wearing masks.
Thank you for that. But I will go into the MIQ review. Given that you and your colleagues had been saying this all the way since April, and it's taken this long for some action to be taking place, what did you think of the recommendations? And also, should they have moved sooner?
Well, science is slow. It's maybe a criticism, but we need to be slow so that we do it right. So it's okay that it takes a little time. We just get there in the end. And the recommendations that they're considering are basically a whole review of the whole MIQ ventilation systems, and to make sure that we're not, you know, recirculating air from maybe one room to another where this type of transmission can happen.
The MIQ report also did state that it was the plausible cause of transmission. Why can't there be more certainty?
Well, we're not doing this in a controlled laboratory environment, so it's really kind of difficult to do it. But with the Grand Mercure instance, where there was someone in MIQ on a different floor where this transmission happened, they think that it actually did go through the ventilation system, which is, of course, a cause of concern.
And there has been extensive assessment of the Grand Millennium's ventilation system, and a remediation plan is being developed. But are the recommendations enough to limit the risk?
Well, that's the thing. We can only try to limit the risk the best we can. That's why we have contact tracing, that's why we wear masks, and that's why we do this thing called social distancing, to try to minimize the chance of transmission.
So is 2 meters enough?
That is a great question, and clearly I would not feel safe at 2 meters, especially where these aerosol transmission events can happen, you know, tens of meters in a room if there isn't proper ventilation. So that recommendation of 2 meters is actually based on old data, and it might be something we need to revise.
And what do you think that new figure might be?
Well, we just need to, I guess, better convey that 2 meters doesn't mean that you're safe. And in fact, in some places, like inside in work areas, they'd say, oh, you need to keep 1 meter distance. But the thing is, it should be the opposite. Indoors is where we need to keep extra distance between people, because that's where there's more likely to have these aerosol transmission events.
Really fascinating insight into how airborne transmission works. And I really appreciate your time, Joel. Just quickly, what TV show would you revive?
I would hope not to revive anything. Let's, do something new and fresh. Although, I did see the latest Mighty Ducks on Disney Plus.
Oh, I love Mighty Ducks. Are you still a big fan?
I have to be. Yeah, I'm from Minnesota and I play ice hockey.
Good for you. Thanks very much, Joel, for joining us this morning. It's Joel Rindelaub, Research Fellow at Auckland University of Schools, Chemical Sciences.